The Philippine Agriculture Chief gives rice importers 30 days to use their import permits or lose them. He issues the deadline as prices of the staple grain begin to spike in Metro Manila. Jervis Manahan reports.
In a congressional hearing on Monday, Agriculture Secretary Francisco T. Laurel Jr. warned rice importers that their import clearances will be forfeited if their approved volume will not reach the country in 30 days. He said there's 1 million metric tons of rice that's valid to enter the country.
Sabi ko sa kanila, pag hindi nyo import yan within 30 days, hindi kayo mabili ng PO, kakancelin ko lahat yan. Because I don't want to be held hostage by, you know, permits that were issued to them upon their request. Diba? So then yun, wala rin ho akong alam na nagsiset ngayon kung ano dapat ang import volumes.
This comes amidst rising price of rice in most markets in Metro Manila. In Commonwealth Market, rice is being sold at 56 pesos per kilo. The high price alarmed Rice Watch Group Bantay Bigas.
Ito ay napakalayo dun sa binanggit ng Department of Agriculture na dapat ay 48 lang ang presyo ng regular milled rice.
The group belied allegations that the spike is due to high price of palay or unhusked rice. Bantay Bigas asserts the price of rice is still very low in many provinces.
Yung monitoring mismo ng Bantay Bigas ay meron pa ng 15.50 centavos sa albay, presyo ng bagong ani. Ganun sa Mindoro at saka mismo dito sa Laguna ay nananatiling mababa, 20 pesos per kilo.
The Department of Agriculture assured lawmakers on Monday that supply of rice is stable. They said the buffer stock is enough to last until the first quarter of 2024. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
Transport Group Piston says it's a go for day three of its transport strike, which will occur today, Wednesday. This even after transport officials played down the strike's effects. Meanwhile, another transport group, Manibela, is also set to hold its own strike starting today until Friday. Both Piston and Manibela are protesting against the government's PV modernization program, which they believe would bury jeepney operators and drivers in debt.
Mabigat sa kalooban natin na yung kapatid nating Piston, minamaliit. Sinasabi, walang epekto. Hindi naman po yung epekto ang pinag-uusapan natin dito. Ang pinag-uusapan natin dito, yung kabuhayan ng nasa transport sector.
The Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board has insisted they've done what they can to make the program easier to comply with. More remote areas in the Philippines set to benefit from the government's free Wi-Fi program. The Department of Information and Communications Technology announced plans to provide internet access to around 2,000 geographically isolated areas across the country. This initiative is part of the agency's project aimed at expanding internet connectivity to more. The DICT hopes to establish 15,000 free Wi-Fi access points across the country this year and aims to add another 25,000 next year. Students at public schools might soon find their Fridays dedicated to enhancing their learning. You see, the Department of Education has announced plans to reduce its Catch-Up Fridays, to introduce, rather, its Catch-Up Fridays program, which aims in helping students read and comprehend better. The details in this report by Joyce Balancho.
The Department of Education, or DepEd, will soon order schools to designate Friday of every week as a day for students to catch up on their learning, particularly on reading, values education, health, and peace education. Vice President of Education Secretary Sara Duterte says Catch-Up Fridays will begin on January 12, 2024. Subjects initially scheduled during Fridays will be included in the first 4 days of the week to give way to this new schedule. DepEd will release on December the guidelines for the implementation.
So ito yung strategy natin sa paghahabol sa part ng ating learning recovery program, dahil nakita natin na ginagawa naman natin lahat noon pero hindi pa rin nag-i-improve ang performance ng ating mga learners, particularly sa international assessments.
The Education Secretary cited a recent study by the World Bank which found that learning poverty in the Philippines was at 91% in 2022, which meant 9 out of 10 Filipino children aged 10 still struggled to read simple texts.
Nakikita natin na hindi talaga maganda yung kalidad ng edukasyon. At sisimulan talaga natin dapat na matuto ang mga bata magbasa. And marami talaga tayong mga non-readers at saka marami tayong mga slow readers. Kaya kailangan silang lahat bigyan ng isang araw na wala silang gagawin kundi mag-practice at matuto magbasa. Even yung mga magagaling na natin na magbasa, dapat i-level up yung kanilang reading skills.
Some parents expressed support for the new DepEd program.
Sa amin kasi mas okay kung sa teacher kasi kami kasi may mga trabaho din kami. Minsan hindi namin maasikaso yung mga bata. Parehas kami mag-asawa, may trabaho eh.
Medyo ginagalamay pa niya yung mga pagbabasa. Pero syempre, pag tumagal naman din niya matutukan, matututunan din niya magbasa.
On Tuesday morning, Duterte also led the culmination of the National Reading Month celebration. The DepEd has initiated programs to promote reading among students, including the establishment of reading pantries in schools, as well as activities such as share a book drive and book buddy sessions. Duterte concluded the activities with the launch of the children's book Isang Kaibigan, which she personally wrote for young learners.
Merong isang ibon at marami siyang kaibigan. Merong nangyaring unos sa buhay niya at nawala lahat ng mga kaibigan niya. Akala niya nawala lahat pero merong isa na bumalik at tumulong sa kanya. At yun yung lesson doon sa libro, yung friendship and kindness.
In her speech during the event, Duterte stressed the importance of reading among young learners and how this foundational skill would support them as they achieve their goals.
Mamagitan ng pagbabasa, maaari kayong mamuhay sa mundo kung saan makakayanan ninyong abutin ang inyong mga pangarap. Ang pagbabasa ang susi na magbubukas ng mga kahangahangang bagay para sa bawat isa sa inyo.
She also urges parents to encourage their children to find interest in reading, the same way she was taught by her mother. Joyce Balancho, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine Vice President Sara Duterte vows to support her father should he run for public office again. Former President Rodrigo Duterte earlier said on an evening SMNI show that he would run for senator or vice president if his daughter were to be impeached. Sara insists the former chief executive has their full family support. A lawmaker has claimed some members of the House of Representatives plan to file an impeachment case against the vice president.
Kung ano man yung desisyon ni Pangulong Duterte ay buo ang suporta ng pamilya sa kanya. Just like kung ano man yung mga desisyon namin na mga anak regarding sa politika, buo din yung suporta ng pamilya sa amin. Ganun din ang suporta namin sa desisyon ni Pangulong Duterte.
Two Philippine House lawmakers urged the Marcos Jr. administration to cooperate with an international probe of the Duterte government's bloody drug war. The appeal is contained in a resolution filed by the House Human Rights Committee Chair Bienvenido Abante and Party List Representative Ramon Gutierrez. It is the second House resolution that calls on the government to cooperate with the International Criminal Court. The resolution says the Philippine government showed respect for the ICC proceedings and the rule of international law when it initially asked the ICC to defer its investigation. It also notes the Philippine Supreme Court acknowledged the ICC's jurisdiction over alleged crimes against humanity that may have occurred in the Philippines while it was a member state. Philippine President Marcos Jr. and other justice officials earlier said the government will not cooperate with the ICC probe since the Philippines withdrew in 2019 from the treaty establishing the ICC. Seven more witnesses against former Philippine Senator Leyla de Lima offered to recant their statements in her last drug case. The seven persons deprived of liberty wrote to Muntinlupa, RTC Branch 206 Judge Henerguito to express their intention to recant. They said they were forced to testify against de Lima. They insisted any judicial statements they've made are void of lack of consent. The seven had accused de Lima of receiving money from illegal drug trade in New Bilibid Prison. They also requested to be transferred from Sablayan Penal Colony to NBP. Last November 13, de Lima was released on bail after nearly 7 years of incarceration. More lawmakers jumping ship from the once-dominant PDP Laban Party of former President Rodrigo Duterte. Agusan del Norte's 2nd District Representative Dale Cordova and Caloocan City's Mitch Cahayun Uy were among the old PDP Laban members who joined Lakas CMD. That's the political party of House Speaker Martin Romualdez. The new transfer brought Lakas CMD's strength in the House of Representatives to 86 members. Meanwhile, from a high of 120 lawmakers during the term of Duterte, the PDP Laban is now down to just 13 congressmen. Its Vice President Johnny Pimentel expects more members leaving the party in the coming weeks. He also attributed the shift to the upcoming election period, as well as tensions between Duterte and the House. The three-day joint military activity between Manila and Washington officially kicks off. The first air and sea patrols took place Tuesday in waters near Taiwan. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., who just came back from his week-long U.S. trip, said the initiative signifies the two countries' commitment to maintain security in the region. He earlier said peace can only be achieved through a strong partnership with allies.
Despite the evolving and complex challenges, my message was one of optimism, that together with the U.S., our oldest and only treaty ally, and our growing network of other partners, we will be able to bring peace, stability, prosperity to the Indo-Pacific region. As long as our partnerships are based on mutual trust and respect for one another as sovereign equals, and that our actions are anchored in international law, including the UNCLOS and the 2016 Arbitral Award.
Efforts to hold joint patrols with U.S. came amid rising maritime tensions between Manila and Beijing. The activities will end tomorrow, November 23rd, in the West Philippine Sea. The death from the strong quake that struck southern Mindanao last week has risen to 11. The Philippine Health Department reported this Tuesday. It adds there were 740 casualties from the tremor, with 41 still admitted in hospitals. The Mindanao quake affected nearly 13,000 people and damaged over 800 houses. Let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Veronica Torres. Hi, Veronica.
Good morning to you and to all of our audience. As of today, shear line is affecting the northern sections of southern Luzon and Visayas, while northeast monsoon is affecting the rest of Luzon. So, for Visayas, Bicol region, Mindoro, Quezon, and the Banga Peninsula, we're expecting cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms caused by shear lines. It's possible, in fact, are flash floods or landslides due to moderate to at times heavy rains. For Cagayan Valley and Aurora, we're expecting cloudy skies with light rains due to northeast monsoon. For Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we're expecting partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated light rains. And for the rest of Mindanao, partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated rain showers or thunderstorms is expected. We also have a gale warning raised over the seaboards of northern Luzon, the eastern seaboards of central Luzon, and the eastern seaboards of southern Luzon and Visayas. So sea travel is risky for those small sea vessels. And that's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center, Veronica Torres.
Thank you very much for that update, Veronica.